In our continuing story of disbelief, we discovered that the skeptical philosophies that had emerged in ancient Greece and in Rome were by 500 AD facing a serious challenge. Christianity had taken over as the official religion of the Roman Empire and was to become the Roman Catholic Church. It had closed down the Greek schools of philosophy that had encouraged a rational materialist view of the universe. And Christianity was to dominate Western thought, and to some extent politics too, for more than 1,000 years. It was an extraordinary success story. And in such a world, there didn't seem much place for disbelief.
Major funding for this program is provided by the Center for Inquiry, working to promote and defend reason, science, freedom of inquiry, and ethical alternatives in all areas of human endeavor. Additional support is provided by the American Ethical Union, a federation of humanistic religious communities, celebrating the worth and dignity of every person. The American Humanist Association, tomorrow's values today. The Institute for Humanist Studies, inspired by humanity, guided by reason. And the HKH Foundation.
The subject of atheism has sparked a major cultural and religious discussion in America. Best-selling books, press reports, and magazine articles are fueling the dialogue. The first ever television exploration of the idea that God doesn't exist was broadcast in England in 2005. A Brief History of Disbelief, the three-part series, is a personal essay by Jonathan Miller, author, lecturer, producer, and director. Now, at a time of growing debate over faith versus reason, it is being offered for the first time to viewers in America. Here is the second hour.
In spite of the continuing success of Christianity, it's not hard to find in Europe today the unused ruins of this once all-powerful church. So what happened exactly? It's very hard in the 21st century to get a real sense of the mentality of the past, especially when it comes to attitudes towards religion. Given the fact that we now live in a literate society, in which almost everyone can read and write, it may not be too difficult for the historians of the future to uncover the opinions and beliefs of so-called ordinary people. But when we look back to, say, the 13th century, when this abbey was founded, the thoughts of the mass of the blamelessly illiterate have left no mark on the historical record.
But to uncover the story of disbelief, we have to understand the background of belief against which any skeptical thoughts had to compete. In order to get some insight into the religious mentality, we have to look at the way in which such ideas were communicated to those who were unable to read by looking at religious pictures.
This, of course, is the Scrovegni Chapel in Padua, where Giotto, one of the great pioneers of European art, painted a series of frescoes at the beginning of the 14th century. The pictures offer an accessible, almost comic strip version of the life and death of Christ.
With the astonishingly rapid onset of Christianity, religious belief in Europe underwent a far-reaching and irreversible change in its character. Although it took some time for the creed, the sacraments, and the liturgy to settle down into their canonical form, there soon began to emerge a sacred text
supervised, maintained, and interpreted by a centralized dogmatic authority. And instead of the loose and somewhat unauthorized folklore of pagan antiquity, there began to emerge articles of faith, the most important of which, inherited from the Jews, was the idea that there was one and only one God who had created the world with the express purpose of giving his most favored creature the awesome privilege of exercising moral choice. Adorazione qui.
Adorazione dei magi.
Dei magi, sì.
L'espressione della Madonna, questa è bellissima, eh?
Sì.
Presa da vicino è bellissima, l'espressione della Madonna quando è presente, vedi, hai l'immagine. Bellissima da lì.
Sì, questo è un bambino normale.
Normale, esatto, proprio così.
The other distinctive feature of this story is the fact that in contrast to the weightless, undated episodes of pagan mythology, the events described in the New Testament took place in what seems to be a relatively recent past. L'ultima cena.
L'ultima cena. Lavaggio dei piedi.
Sì.
Bacio di Giuda.
Buongiorno.
Quando
sì.
Gesù va davanti a
sì.
Caifa. Calvario. Crocifissione. Deposizione.
Resurrezione. Against a background like this, which subtly alternates between the mundane and the miraculous, and in which the extraordinary events of the New Testament were given a curious sort of documentary credibility, disbelief would have been almost inconceivable. Looking up at these 700-year-old pictures, I'm struck by the way in which they and what they represented must have dominated the mentality of their 14th century observers. In contrast to Judaism and Islam, which prohibited pictorial representation, Christianity virtually reveled in it. The result was that the Christian imagination was more or less surrounded by an impenetrable cyclorama of sacred imagery. But even in a secular building such as this, this is the Palace of Justice, although this vast array of frescoes includes many subjects which are not strictly religious, you still get an overwhelming impression of how closed the medieval mind really was. But things were about to change. Although you don't get the slightest intimation of it in panels such as these, by the time they were being painted in the middle of the 15th century, there were philosophical stirrings within the academic community here in Padua, which represented hidden currents of skepticism and disbelief. Actually, it occurs to me that there are two unacknowledged streams of thought which Orthodox people are beginning to refer to as atheist. And they come from two sources that work, in a sense, at right angles to one another. One, if you like, is a horizontal influence arising from the effects of increasing worldwide travel, with the discovery that people don't necessarily share the same beliefs. It became clear that there were other worlds that were not even Christian in previously unvisited parts, in which people were quite unaware of Christianity. In the 17th century, Jesuit missionaries had come back from China and had to reconcile themselves with the fact that there were civilizations in which Christianity had no place whatsoever. But their philosophy nevertheless satisfied and sustained a moral world for at least 300 million people. And then, a little later, you have a vertical influence bubbling up from the past in various forms of Greco-Roman pagan skepticism and materialism. It's a sort of artesian well, bringing up pre-Christian ideas from Epicurus, Lucretius, and Democritus.
Fear is the mother of all gods.
Nature does all things spontaneously by herself, without their meddling.
Having closed down the philosophical schools in Athens, the newly converted Christian Roman Empire made strenuous efforts to Christianize some of the earlier pagan philosophies. One or two of the works of Aristotle and Plato had survived and were known, but the only ones which were valued in the early Middle Ages were those remnants which conveniently supported the new Christian theology. And the unequivocally materialist philosophers such as Epicurus, Democritus, and Lucretius were simply dismissed as disbelieving villains and their work discarded. But Arabic scholars in the Middle East and later in Spain had preserved the entire body of Aristotle's work, and writers such as Averroes in 12th century Toledo had begun to recognize in Aristotle aspects of his thought which were not so conveniently consistent with any religious thought at all. Aristotle's idea that the world had always existed and that there might, after all, not be an immortal soul were obviously inconsistent with Christian and, in fact, with Muslim thought. Averroes versions of Aristotle were soon translated into the international language of Latin and made their way throughout Christian Europe, especially to Padua, the very city where the Scrovegni Chapel and the Palace of Reason stood as mute but articulate witnesses to the pervasiveness of Christian faith. And there, and in fact throughout Europe over the next 500 years, thoughtful men, very few of whom are now household names, transformed these ancient ideas into what would eventually emerge as confident modern atheism. And all of this had already begun to happen by the time the medieval frescoes were being painted onto the walls we were looking at in Padua's Palace of Justice.
Well, as you might expect, this huge municipal hall is now used to house modern exhibitions.
And in fact, it's quite difficult to visualize the intervening transformations of thought which link the emblematic piety of these medieval frescoes with the profane secularism of the exhibition here, dedicated to the art and technology of the 1960s. The advent of new science and technology in the Renaissance would also have a role to play in the gradual erosion and undermining of the monolithic confidence of the Christian world. In fact, the conventional view is that science, by mechanizing the world picture, was the most significant factor in undermining religious faith. But although this sounds quite reasonable, it's far from being the truth. It's true that Christianity had inherited the Ptolemaic picture of the universe, in which the Earth stood at the very center of everything, and everything else revolved around it, the sun, the moon, the planets, and the stars, in concentric spheres. And all this, of course, was the work of an omnipotent God. It's not hard to see why people had believed the Earth to be the center of the universe, around which everything else revolved. After all, you could see it happening. The sun went round the Earth every day. You could see it. The moon went round the Earth at night, and you could actually see it. Even the stars revolved around the Earth, at least if you were patient enough to notice them. And if man lived as the supreme creature on a world that was at the center of everything, well, it wasn't hard to think of himself as the very special creation of one God. But this reassuring view of the universe and of man's privileged place within it was about to be modified. With Copernicus, Galileo, and then Kepler, it soon became apparent that the Earth and all the planets revolved around the Sun, which was itself just one star amongst millions of others.